David Meniketti, how did you first learn about the hearing aid project?
I believe my manager told me about it and mentioned, of course, what the whole project was about and said, we need you to come down to L.A. and be here at this day, and here's what's going to happen. It was just simple as that, pretty much.
Were you able to come prepared? Did they send you like a tape and some lyrics, or did everything?
No, absolutely not. And I think everyone showed up that day not knowing what the song was or how it was. And of course, we were hearing a playback of it that Ronnie played for all of the guys that were singing the backgrounds that night. And he just basically came to the choruses and said, here's what we're going to sing. So it was sort of on the fly, as we say, you know, it was done right there on the spot. None of us had any advance hearing of the song except people in his band, of course.
Yeah. Do you remember if you sang more lines than ended up in on the track, on the record?
Oh, yeah. As far as the lead singing part, yes, yeah. Absolutely. Because what happened was that we all did the choruses on one night, and that was the most active, crazy night. That's when all the people were there. Every rock star, everybody from the press was there. It was madness. I mean, there were hundreds of people in the hallways, and all the adjoining doorways were open for A&M Studios, and everybody was talking to each other. There were interviews going on. There were all kinds of things happening. It was crazy. And plus, they started guitar solos that same evening as well. So a lot of the people hung out and watched certain guitar players do their solos, so it was pretty active. But the lead singing part didn't happen till the next day. So I knew that I had to come back in the morning and lead vocals. And again, I had never heard the entire song. We had only really heard the solo section and the parts that we were singing the choruses on. So when I came back and the next morning, we were talking about absolute madness the night before, and now there's nobody there except Ronnie Dio, the engineer, maybe two or three other people, and a video crew. And a very small video crew at that, maybe two people or something like that. So it was very, very small, very, very low key. And all the fun of the previous night was all gone, and it was all about business. So I got in there, and I was the very first singer to actually sing the song all the way through, other than Ronnie himself. So basically what happened was I got in there and put my headphones on, and Ronnie played the whole song back to me with his vocal on it, and singing the entire song, so that I had a guide to know, you know, what the basic melody of the verses were and the bridges and so on and so forth. So it was just very quick. I mean, it was a one-time thing. He just played it once, and then I said, okay, here's a lyric sheet in front of you. Go ahead, sing it.
Did you have any idea on which of your lines that would be used before the album came out?
No, and I'm sure that Ronnie didn't either. I was the first guy to sing on there, so I'm sure he wanted to just, you know, get everyone's vocals on there, and then he would make that very tough decision, I'm sure, for him and for everybody around, whoever was making that decision, to do that. You know, it was cool. I mean, it was great. I sang it through, I believe, only one time. And I was sort of nervous because I'm singing in front of Ronnie James Dio. I mean, he's basically sitting there listening to me and commenting, you know, in the studio. So, and again, it was early in the morning. It was 9 a.m. So, you know, I didn't know how it was all going to turn out, but he really loved my performance, and he was very complimentary, and he didn't even ask me to do it again. So I thought,
that's
okay.
A good sign.
Yeah. And then at the very end of the song, as it was basically going out, there were many, many choruses in a row. And I know that the band played probably, you know, of another 2 minutes worth of the end of the song, just so that were, you know, if they wanted to put more things on it at the end as it was fading out. So he just said, why don't you just do some ad-lib lines at the end, like, whoa, whoa, or something like that, you know. And so I just did, and he ended up using some of those as well of my vocal tracks. So that was fun. And then, of course, when the whole thing came out, I was happy that, you know, outside of the actual intro of the song, I was the very first person to sing the first verse. So that was fun.
Yeah. What was the atmosphere like? Was it just a party and having a good time? Or was there kind of a contest between, you know, the guitar players and the vocalists to do the best performance and to be the most important musician at the place?
Well, you know, it's musicians, so of course, there's always a little bit of competition. That's the spirit of it, I think. And some people are a little more competitive than others. And I felt like, as probably most people did, that it was really a party, and it was just a super fun affair. And the fact that we could all be there at the same time and meet each other, or if we knew each other previously, you know, say hi again. And so that part was really great. And as far as us singing the chorus together, there were some people that were probably a little bit more forward in the way that they tried to do their performance, you know, trying to impress Ronnie, I think, and the room. but for the most part, we just all, you know, I was back there with Don Dock and quite a few other people and on the last row at the top. And we were just having fun, you know. And of course, at the same time, because everybody was also having fun, it was going to be a very difficult situation for Ronnie to basically control us, because everybody was trying to make a joke or talking, you know, but when Ronnie would speak, everybody would shut up. So that was good. I mean, he did command our attention quite well. So that everybody respected him so much. So that at least was handled quite well.
Yes,
so,
sir.
You know, probably took a little bit longer than he wanted it to take, but it was not bad. And then once that was done and we were done with that vocal part, then the guitar solo started, and that's when, you know, other people would eventually break off from hanging out and talking to the press or talking to each other, and a few of us would go into the control room and watch certain guitar players do their solos. Actually, I think I only went in there to watch one guitar player do a solo, and that was Yngwie of Malmsteen. And
yeah.
And I was in there with probably about 8 or 9 other guitar players. A friend of mine at the time was Neil Sean, and he was standing next to me, and we were, you know, we were just literally almost laughing out loud because the guy is so amazing, you know, that we're like going, how the hell do you play like that? You know, like, I don't know how that's humanly possible. But you know, and Yngwie was just standing a few feet away from us because he did all the solos were done in the control room with the amplifier out in the room, of course, being mic'd. But and I saw a few other people getting prepared, like George Lynch and things like that. You could tell he was very intense and he was trying to make sure his fingers were in good shape. It was funny to watch, but you know, it was fun at the same time.
Yeah, you had been in the music business for a lot of years already. Were there certain artists you were excited to meet? I mean, you mentioned Dio, but...
Yeah, I mean, there were a few people. I mean, I knew probably 75% of the people that were there just through us playing shows together or having met at another time. But there were a few people, like, I had never met or talked to, at least, like Jeff Tate, and I don't remember if I ended up talking to him or not, but as it turned out, years later, we ended up becoming friends, so it was, you know, that was kind of interesting. But there were probably another few singers that I had not met before, and but you know, the whole night was so crazy, and there were so many people packed into that A&M studio hallway and everything else. And there were all of these interviews going on, you know, literally on the fly. I mean, people would just grab you and go, hey, come over here. I want to ask you some questions, you know. And sometimes they'd take two or three different, you know, artists from different bands and put them together. So it was kind of fun. It was crazy. It was nonstop. You know, you can imagine. I mean, it's the '80s, and you know, everything was going on that you could ever have go on at a place with a lot of rock stars.
More than 35 years later, what do you think about the track "Stars"?
Oh, it was great. You know, I mean, to me, it did exactly what he wanted. You know, I'm talking about Ronnie, obviously. He was trying to, I think, get a little bit more respect from the industry for our style of music. You know, the straight ahead, hard rock, heavy metal, whatever you wanted to call it at that time. And it was just that you know, the fact that he had the ability to command such respect from the industry of other artists, you know, that he was able to put this all together. It was very cool. I mean, I think it did everything that he wanted it to do. Maybe it didn't make as much money for, you know, the charity that, you know how those things go. I mean, certainly he's not Michael Jackson. We're not Michael Jackson. So you're never going to have that kind of cachet, you know, with the industry for being sort of, you know, if you think about our style of music, it was always kind of, oh, yeah, everyone knows it's popular, but we don't want to talk about it kind of stuff, you know? I mean, as far as the mainstream was concerned, like, you know, you're never going to see 5 Grammy Awards for heavy metal, you know? I mean, it's just not going to happen. So, you know, to some degree, he was trying to legitimize the whole idea that, yes, we have something to contribute as well. And I think it worked.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, I was going to tell you that when I came in at 9 a.m. to sing, the second singer after me was Rob Halford, and Rob was in the hallway waiting for me to finish my performance, and I stayed a little while afterwards after I sang to watch a little bit of Rob as well. So that was fun.
Yeah, it would have been so interesting to hear all the takes. I mean, you singing the whole song and Rob singing the whole song. I guess the tapes.
You never know. Yeah, I mean that could be one of these things, because there's so much stuff that comes out on YouTube. You know, so many years later. Hey, here's the entire soloed, you know, drum track of this great song or whatever. You know, it's very possible that there could be something like that that comes out. It might be embarrassing. Who knows? You know, if you just solo something, who knows? But
well, you sing the song for the first time, so I guess,
yeah, exactly. Yeah.